Poor boy, what have I got myself into? Hi everyone, it's Dallas and welcome to my first video for February. It's currently the 27th today, but I have accumulated quite a few new books through the month of January and February. If you haven't realised why I've been gone, I'll have a video that I put up just before this one that explains what happened, but having a death in the family did not stop my buying at all. In fact, I think it sort of exacerbated a tendency that I already had, which was to get myself lost in books. But I will just give you a quick run through of what I've bought and what I've read so far. But first off, I think I will begin with the little Funko haul that I occasionally do. My local sanity is going out of Funkos for some reason. I think from what I remember talking to the staff worker there, that they're not getting reliable orders coming in and it's just not worth the hassle. So at the moment they're half price. So I got a gorgeous little Sabrina, the original Sabrina. If I can focus. There we go. The gorgeous original little Sabrina. The next one is one of my orders that came in. The second one, I get to pick it up tomorrow, but I just couldn't wait any longer to do a book haul. So it is one of the Stephen King Funkos. So here we go. Focus on the Stephen King. There you go. So this Stephen King is just with his glasses and a book. It's not the variation one, which I will pick up tomorrow, but anyway. So they're the two Funkos. Oh, I've been trying to put this off. Okay, I will start with the books that I have bought in the last couple of weeks that I have read. First off, Werewolves Only by Carrie Pulkinen. Hope I pronounced that right. I bought this because, let's face it, the Kindle edition was like $6. This paperback copy was $4.90 from Amazon. So, saving money where I can. However, I just found it to be like a generic urban fantasy, slightly romancy. I just found it quite boring. It was, you know, 3 stars. It wasn't exceptional. Yeah, that's about it. I can't even really bring up a lot of memorable bits in it. I read this, you know, a couple of weeks ago. I don't think I'll continue on with the series, but it was interesting to read just to get potentially a new author. So there's that. The next one is a book that I think I read either in late December or early January from my library's Overdrive catalogue, and it was Death in a Budapest Butterfly. Now this I loved. I think it's sold as a cozy mystery, like a Berkeley, yeah. And it is just so sweet. This woman that helps run a tea shop with her mother and her grandmother, they are from, I think it's Polish ancestry. No, Hungarian, I'm very sorry, Hungarian ancestry. And the Hungarian ancestry and folklore and superstitions play a massive part because the main character, who is Hannah, she comes across at one of the antique stores that she frequents a beautiful little teacup with a saucer, but the teacup has a butterfly for a handle and it's beautifully decorated and very sweet. And her grandmother asks her to put it on this table for this, you know, catered event that they're having at their tea shop. And during the event, Hannah notices that the teacup isn't where she left it. Nobody was supposed to drink out of it. It was just for decoration. It's brand new, old and expensive. And she happens to see it in the hands of a strange woman who was drinking out of it. Now, something happens after that, and of course that's what sets the mystery, you know, off. But it was just very well done. I loved seeing into a community that I personally don't know anybody in. And just there's so many food references and it's just, oh, it was just so sweet. I raced through this, bought this soon after I read the ebook. I've got the second book on pre-order. I just can't wait to read it because I just had so much fun with that. And on the opposite end of the scale, coincidentally, Shadow Warrior by Christine Feehan. Oh boy, I think this is about book 4 or 5 in her Shadow Riders. I've given up. I really have. The story sounds like it should be good, but it seems to me that Christine Feehan as an author has gone from just writing great books that happen to have some intimate moments, sex scenes, whatever you want to call them, to having books that have massive chunks of sexual content and a story that sort of links all those scenes. It's more on the, I think you would call it the erotica end of paranormal romance. It's not about the murder mystery. It's literally about getting these two people to hook up. And I'm over it. You know, I want a story. The story sounds great. But I just, no, I'm over these characters. I'm over the series. I think I'm over Christine Feehan as an author because the Torpedo Inc. series is exactly like this as well. And they do things that are, I suppose you could consider them sometimes emotionally abusive. There's like emotionally blackmailing. There's, yeah, it's just, it's very hard for me to sort of put my finger on exactly, apart from the, you know, huge amount of explicit sexual content that are in these now. But it's just, yeah, it's just something that I'm not enjoying. I don't even enjoy the characters. So this is a series that I think I'm going to finish it with here because I'm just, it's just not for me. I'm just, I don't know. Am I getting too old? I don't know. However, to counteract that, we have another book that I really enjoyed. I picked up an author I discovered a couple of years ago, and I have enjoyed every book bar one of the books that I've read. I think this is about book 6 or 7 at the moment. And that is Susanna Kearsley. I finally found The Splendour Falls, and I really liked it. I really enjoyed this. If you have read her books before, this is a bit like The Shadowy Horses cross with Season of Storms. That's the vibe I got from it. And if you do have a problem with some of her extended chapters where she has the characters from her past timeline, you know, with these big long sequences, there's only 2 or 3 small mentions, so this might be the book for you. This book, Emily travels, let me see, where's she going? She's going to somewhere in Italy because her cousin is an archaeologist and he wants to discover this long since dead queen's hidden treasure that's supposedly hidden in one of the underground tunnels somewhere in the city. The characters that are in this are really well done. There are some surprising twists, and one of the characters that I thought she would end up with, I won't spoil it, it was just really well done, and I'm just, oh, this would make a great TV or movie adaptation. I just loved it. So yeah, I'm definitely not finished with my Susanna Kearsley journey. The last two books that I have bought so far and read already are Demon's Dance by Keri Arthur. Now, I've read all these books so far on the Kindle, but I've been slowly snagging them in paperback when I find them cheap on Amazon. This one was under $10, so they usually sit around the mid-20s. I know, expensive, but self-published, I can't do anything about it. So I snag them when they're on special. Like I said, this is urban fantasy set in a rural setting outside Melbourne, Victoria. I just love them. It's so wonderful to see books set in Australian outback or even in Australia, most urban fantasies, and even contemporary books, unless you're reading like Mills and Boone or something. There's not a lot that I see that really catches my attention that is set in Australia and just is very evocative of the setting. The bushland here, the scrub, oh, it's just, you know, I could walk out my door and in 500 metres I'm in the scrub, so yeah, it was wonderful to pick up a copy of a book that I love, and I think the 6th book is out in a couple of months, so put that on your calendar if you read Keri Arthur. And the final book is Consumed by J.R. Ward. Now, I have read her Black Dagger series. I picked up the first books in the, you know, the original 6 books back when they were being published, so I've been on the bandwagon for quite a while. I think I read 2 or 3 books after the original 6, you know, Black Dagger Brotherhood brothers. I didn't like them so much, so, you know, I haven't continued on. But when I saw this and I read the two free samples that are on Amazon Kindle, I thought, yes, I've got to get this. Amazingly enough, this was being sold out as a bargain book, I think about $4 something, so I snapped it up. I'm going to put this down for a sec. I assumed, for some reason, that the first couple of chapters in the book would be those books that we saw, like the free chapters on Kindle. Turns out, no. And it really is necessary to read those free, not novellas, but I'm not quite short stories. They continue on, like you've got the just before the wedding party, and then this picks up a little while after. And it was such a good read. It reminded me a lot of Nora Roberts with her, I think, Chasing Fire and her Blue Smoke, both regarding firefighters, because the two central characters of this story are firefighters. I won't give away what happens in this because there are some really, I won't say shocking turns of events, but there are some very surprising character developments that, let's just say, I haven't seen them before. Actually, I don't think in any of the, I mean, like, my library is quite big. I've got, you know, close to 2,000, 2,500 books in my house, and I haven't come across a character that's actually had to do this to another character, so, yeah, it was a very interesting story regarding character growth and character development and understanding yourself and all those kinds of themes. Yeah, it was just really good. I flew through it and I really enjoyed it. So if you're looking for a contemporary romance that has action and heart-stopping moments, because, you know, firefighters, with a bit of suspense thrown in there and a couple of murder mystery twists, try Consumed. It was really good and I really enjoyed it. I can't wait to see if there's a book two, perhaps, maybe. Okay, on to my last pile, which I will drag over here. Okay, we will start with the books that I have received most recently in the post. This one came yesterday. It is Stephen Leather's Nightfall, the first book in the Jack Nightingale series. I don't think I've seen anybody who's read this or recommended it. However, I have seen the Kindle edition floating around. It sometimes gets recommended to me, you know, thanks to my Clive Barker and Stephen King, you know, purchases. And this one, it was like, it really sounds good. Okay, I'll just read you the synopsis. I won't do this for the others because you'll probably have heard of these, but this one, this is why this caught my attention. You're going to hell, Jack Nightingale. These are the words that ended his career as a police negotiator. Now Jack's a struggling PI and the chilling words come back to haunt him. Nightingale's life is turned upside down the day he inherits a mansion with a priceless library. It comes from a man who claims to be his father, and it comes with a warning. That Nightingale's soul was sold at birth, and a devil will come to claim it on his 33rd birthday, just 3 weeks away. Jack does not believe in hell, probably doesn't believe in heaven either, but when people close to him start to die horribly, he is led to the inescapable conclusion that real evil may be at work, and if he doesn't find a way out, he'll be damned in hell for eternity. Yes, please. That's all I can say. Yes, please. The next book is one that I have seen floating around. It was such a hyped book a couple of years ago. I have been recently re-listening to the Death by the Books podcast, and this often comes up. It had an episode that was mainly devoted to it, but it is often sort of just sprinkled in there somewhere as a book that especially Kearsley loves. Reader, I caved. I bought Jane Steele. Don't get me wrong, I liked Jane Eyre. It wasn't my favourite book ever. I am still, I think, an Austen girl at heart. You know, I prefer Jane Austen, just a personal preference. But this one, I do like a retelling. And I'm not quite sure if it's set in a modern era or if it's set in the 20th century, but I'm definitely going to give it a go. So that is one for the BookTube recommendations. On to my fancy pants books that I picked up. I finally picked up a copy of Christina Rossetti's The Goblin Market and Other Poems. I do like Christina Rossetti. I discovered her in the 90s when I was doing some volunteer work at my old school library. Oh, that really dates me. And it has one of my favourite poems in there. The one that starts, it's called Song, and it starts as, "When I'm dead, my dearest, sing no sad songs for me. Plant thou no roses at my head, nor shady cypress tree. Be the green grass above me, with showers and dewdrops wet, and if thou wilt remember, and if thou wilt, forget. So I won't spoil the rest of the poem for you, but I have loved it for so long. But the one I bought along with that goes to my Discworld collection, and that is the cloth-bound version of Unseen Academicals by Terry Pratchett. And this is a chunky one. I didn't realise it was quite so chunky compared to all his other books. It's, how many pages is this little barnacle? Yeah, it's almost 540 pages, and I didn't think Terry Pratchett's books were that long, but this one is. So that's on my to-be-read pile one of these days when I get all the Terry Pratchetts. This next one was another cheap one. Picked it up because why not? John Varley's Irontown Blues. It's an Eight Worlds novel. I have no idea what the Eight Worlds novel series is about. Never read John Varley, but this one sounded really good. It's more science fiction, or not steampunk, but it's a combination of those kind of genres. This guy, Christopher, was a policeman in one of the largest lunar cities when the AI lunar central computer had a breakdown known as the Big Glitch. The problem turned out to be a larger war than anyone could expect. When order was restored, his life was never be the same. Now he's a private detective, assisted by his genetically altered dog, Sherlock, and emulates the tough guys in the noir movies and books that he loves. I didn't need to read any further. I picked it up, and I will get to it at some stage. These next couple are just because... well, just because. Anyway, The Magic Toy Shop, Angela Carter. I think everyone knows what that one's about, so I don't think I need to go into it. This one I have seen hyped just a smidge, but, you know, no reviews really per se, just people mentioning that they're hauling it. And that is The Horder by Jess Kidd. Now, this book is also known as... I think it's Mr. Flood's Last Resort. Yeah, anyway, this was the cheaper version, you know, being a bit cheap here at the moment. So I picked this up. It sounds interesting, maybe a little bit of magical realism, I don't know, but, you know, it'll be there when I want to read it. This is another case of being cheaper than the Kindle, so Better Haunts and Garden Gnomes, an Unlucky Valley series by Michelle M. Pillow. I've read one or two of her books before. I think it's in the Happy Everlasting series, maybe, something like that. Anyway, thought I'd give it a go. You know, your usual sort of paranormal romance. I think I need a water break. Okay, I picked up book two in the Dr. Greta Helsing series, Dreadful Company by Vivian Shaw. The first book, very slow paced, very odd, was set in London. This book, we move to Paris. I think the doctor's at a conference and, you know, supernatural things go wrong. So, you know, I'm down to the last five books. Thank God. Okay, this book... I've never read Faye Weldon before, but I saw this one, The Spa Decameron. Now, I do have the Decameron on my classics shelves over here. I have been planning to read it. And when I saw this and saw it was basically a retelling of sorts, in this one there is a gathering of high-achieving ladies at a remote, expensive castle spa over the 10 days of Christmas and New Year's. So each day, each one of these ladies is retelling a story. You get the drift, so that's why it's called The Spa Decameron. I haven't started this one yet because I don't know whether to read the Decameron first or just to pick this one up. So that's usually where I run into troubles. Let me know down below in the comments which one you'd recommend because I think I need a bit of help with that. Anyway, this other one, found it, Amazon, Ruth Ware, my first Ruth Ware, The Death of Mrs. Westaway. I've heard it's pretty good, murder mystery, crime thriller. And on to my final three books now. These all happen to have been adapted, strangely enough. I didn't plan on that. The first one is one that everybody knows because it's going around at the moment. It is the first book in the Witcher series, which is the collection of short stories, The Last Wish. I am not in the mood for this at the moment, strangely enough. I was searching for this all through January at my local Big W because that's the only big department store we have out here in country Queensland where I am. Picked it up about 2 weeks ago, but I'm not in the mood for it, so it's just going to sit. The next one is another Faye Weldon book. I haven't read this one, and it sounded fascinating. The Life and Loves of a She-Devil. And I'm thinking, that sounds really strangely familiar when I read the synopsis, and then I'm like, I wonder if it's related to that Roseanne Barr movie from, the, you know, the 90s, She-Devil. Turns out, yep, this is the inspiration for the Roseanne Barr slash, I think it's Meryl Streep movie adaptation from the mid-90s, She-Devil, so I will be reading this at some stage. I thought it was probably better not to read it for Valentine's Day. And finally, the last book. Oh, you're a troublesome little bunny. The Hellbound Heart by Clive Barker. Now, This has been, of course, adapted into Hellraiser with the iconic character of Pinhead, as you can see on the cover. I didn't realise it was quite so short. And then I was really shocked when I opened it up because I thought, oh, well, you know, small writing, it's going to be fine. I'm going to get a decent story. Look at this text. Look at the size of it. It's massive. Okay, if I just pick up consumed, okay, this is still sitting on my pile here. Consumed, the hellbound heart. What the hell? I think if you actually scaled this font down to a normal sized font instead of a large type, you'd probably be like 20 pages less. And I think the book only clocks in at 164 pages as it is. But I love this cover. It's got a bit of a weird feel to it, like a texture wise. It feels like a bit like vinyl, you know, like those vinyl seats. It's not exactly the most pleasant feel, but the cover art is absolutely delightful, so it definitely suits the theme. I suppose if you've never watched Hellraiser, you may not know what this is about, so I'll just give you a quick recap. Frank Cotton's insatiable appetite for the dark pleasures of pain led him to the puzzle of Le Marchand's box, and from there to a death only a sick-minded soul could invent. But his brother's love-crazed wife, Julia, has discovered a way to bring Frank back, though the price will be bloody and terrible, and there will certainly be hell to pay. So, they're the things that I have purchased in the last sort of 6 weeks or so. I do have, like I said, the other Funko coming tomorrow, but this has been it, and that it doesn't even touch any of the Kindle Unlimited books I have read. I've already surpassed my Goodreads challenge for the year. I set it at 150. I think I'm nearly 200 at the moment just because I've been reading a massive amount of Kindle Unlimited, and they all happen to be mostly urban fantasy or paranormal romance or paranormal cozies, and they fall in between like 150 and just over 200 and something pages, so they're not terribly long. I fly through them. So it's just, I'll have to do a separate video on just the favourite ones that I've come across so far. Okay, that's it. I'm off now. Now I've got to edit this thing. Wish me luck. Okay. Thank you for watching, and until I see you guys next time, happy reading.